And I'm drop dead serious, Josh. I've looked, and I cannot find anywhere throughout church history, like, all these councils, etc., where it's actually been done.
Welcome to Bible Memory Goal. My name is Josh Summers, and that was Professor Tom Meyer. We've had him on an interview about a year and a half ago. The audio wasn't great, so I'm really been excited to get him back on here, not only for just getting to learn a little bit more about how he memorizes the Bible and what his passions are, but also because there's something really cool happening later this month that I want him to tell you about. So let's go ahead and dive in the interview so he can share more about that.
Well, you know, one of the things, we were talking about this before we got started here, and it's actually been a conversation that I've been having with another gentleman about really orality and what it means to hear and speak scripture as opposed to reading it. Because most of us approach, you know, we're taught from a very young age that, you know, Bible time or devotional time means just sitting down and looking and reading the words off of a page. And it sounds like you've got a little bit of passion in this area as well. Obviously, you go around speaking the word. How do you value the speaking and listening over other ways that you engage with the Bible?
That's a million-dollar question, man. You know, look, in many ways, the orality of Scripture has been shattered today, especially in the West, okay? In the world of the Bible and the ancient Near East, there was a tremendous view put on just that, and the power of the spoken word, put a tremendous importance put on the public proclamation, the orality of God's word. God's word originally, keyword originally, is meant more for the ears than the eyes. There's a multitude of verses that have to do with that subject. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And God spake all these words, saying, be doers of the word, not hearers only. I charge you by the Lord, and to 1 Thessalonians, I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read aloud unto all the holy brethren. Well, if that's a charge, and we're supposed to do that, when's the last time you heard someone do that? In 1 Thessalonians on a Sunday? Never. You know, blessed is he who reads aloud. Those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things that are written in it, for the time is near. So originally the Bible is meant more for the ears and the eyes. It's just been flipped on its head since, you know, way after the advent of the printing press, but especially right after the advent of the printing press. Because remember, in antiquity, nobody has a copy of the Bible at home. I mean, the only way you could afford one is if you're rich and famous, like Candace, the queen of Ethiopia. Remember how she, you know, the eunuch bought it for her, and he's reading Acts. I'm not sorry, Acts. It's mentioned in Acts. He's reading Isaiah. Remember when the prophet Philip comes alongside him and he hears him reading it aloud. And so there's just something to that. I kind of compare it to reading Mozart versus hearing Mozart. You know, you could read Mozart on the page. I can't, but maybe you can, Josh. I don't know. But you could read Mozart on the page all the day long, and you could say to yourself, wow, I'll bet you that really sounds awesome. You know, but then to have someone play it who knows what they're doing, right? It's the same thing, but it's not. And that's how it is with Scripture for us who memorize, you know, to be able to go to a church and to have them. Because 1 Timothy 4:13 tells us to do three things. You want to do church, do these three things. One of them is read aloud the Scriptures. Now, I know part of it was because no one had a copy at home, but still, a public proclamation. The Anglicans read a chapter aloud from the Old, a chapter aloud from the New, and a chapter aloud from the Gospels every single week. And that does many things. It instills in the people the hearing of God's word. Because let's get real, like in the most literal sense, we really don't hear the voice of God throughout the week, most of us. In the literal sense, we have his word, he has spoken, but yet we don't hear his voice. It's crazy if you think about it, that God has spoken to you and you don't hear his voice in the literal sense. Because when we read it, like you touched on at home, we don't read it aloud. When we're in the car going to and fro, we're not listening to that. At least in my world, I'm listening to whatever DVD the four kids in the back are listening to, you know? This is just the world that we live in. So we're trying to chip away at it a little bit here, a little bit there, whether, you know, in the classroom with my students, I say, you know, okay, we're going to survey Job. Don't read it. Everyone else will tell you to read it. Just hear it. Listen to it. Whether it's speaking at Sundays or, you know, different churches or volunteering at the museum and other things that we have going on. It's a public proclamation of Scripture, and it's good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, one of the things that I love doing in the evenings with my boys, we have it as, I'm sure a lot of people do this as well, but, I will read a story aloud to them, right? And, they'll be looking at pictures, or sometimes they'll, just be listening to what I'm saying. But there are other times that we've actually purchased the audio Bible, right? For Audible, or I'm not sure where we got it from. And we can just let that play, and they'll be able to listen to parts of, of the story in the Gospels or something like that. And they actually enjoy listening to it a lot. And I can see how much more I think they're getting from it than, especially with my 10-year-old, if I were to just, tell him to read something. Reading retention is something that is learned over time, I'm finding, as I train him up. You know what I mean?
Absolutely, you hit the nail on the head. We do the same exact thing in our house. We do. Most of the nights of the week when it's bedtime, like I said, I've got four kids, 10 and under. I'll tell them, we have a routine, whatever I have in my proverbial Rolodex from memory, right? And they'll pick what they want to hear. And then we'll pray and do that. And then my wife will read, regular books to them or whatever. Then when they go to bed, when we tuck them in and pray with them and kiss them and say good night, right? Then we just, it's so easy. We should all be doing it. You just press play. Right, and you let the word of God, like, wash over them when they're getting into, that. Because look at that, when you go to bed, that's the time your mind really can race, right? That's the time you can become extra anxious and worry about things and etc. And it's the best time. Well, anytime's the best time, but you
Yeah.
know what I mean, right? To set your affection, your mind, your heart on God's word, and to have it play over them. It's not only a fantastic way to memorize it, number one. But number two, just to hear how awesome the reading of it is. Look at the book of Jonah, for example. Do you have Jonah
I don't
memorized,
have that one
Josh?
yet, no.
Okay, well, just in Jonah, like, think of all the different
Oh,
voices you
yeah.
have, right? You've got the narrator, you've got Yahweh, you've got Jonah the prophet, you've got the captain of the ship, you've got the mariners, you've got the king of Nineveh. You got half a dozen voices right there. It's not flat and boring. Right? It's up, down. Are they happy? Are they mad? Are they angry? Are they sad? That's why I compare it to reading Mozart versus playing
Yeah,
Mozart.
I think that's a really cool comparison too to think about. It's like, yeah, it is necessary that you have to have music written down, but that's not the way that it is meant to be consumed. Only a savant, I believe, could probably look over a piece of music that complicated and be able to hear it being played in their head. Along those same lines, there's something happening in Dallas called the Great Recital. It's happening at the Institute of Creation Research. Would you mind telling us a little bit more about what is happening there and why you're so excited about
Well, thanks for asking. And that's your hometown,
it?
right? Dallas area?
It is. Yeah, that's where I grew up and still have family there.
Cool. Well, look, in antiquity, they would publicly proclaim the scriptures. And they would, every 7 years at the Feast of Tabernacles, as you might remember from Sunday school, right? Every 7 years, they would read aloud the law. And the reason they would read it aloud is not only because the people didn't have instant access to the Word of God like we do today, but which was a huge reason that they didn't know it unless someone read it to them, right? So they would read it
Yeah.
aloud to the nation, and with the anticipation, with the hope that the people would know what God required of them, and then they would act accordingly, and God would continue blessing the nation through the public reading and them hearing it and obeying it and putting it then into action. So along those lines, what we're doing is October 11th through the 15th, we're doing something that's never been done before. It hasn't. And I know people say, I've heard a few people here and there say, oh, so and so has the whole New Testament memorized or something like that. I don't believe it. Okay. It is just too massive. It is just too huge for one single person to know word for word for word. I just don't believe it. Okay. But so this is something that is, and it, by the way, when people do that, when they say, well, I have the whole New Testament memorized, it kind of, it's not helpful. It makes it sound like only a very, very few people can memorize large books and large passages. But what this is doing, this presentation we're doing, is it's seven believers from all walks of life, normal people. you know, a church secretary from Houston, a retired math teacher from Kokomo, Indiana, a grandma from New Jersey, you know? So I've collected these friends over the years of ministering, and what we're doing is we're all gathering together during the Feast of Tabernacles, and we're gonna recite from memory, word for word for word, the whole New Testament right before the midterms. Right before the midterms, a public proclamation of the oracles of the living God. What does God require of us? And like you mentioned, that the Institute of Creation Research, ICR, has been kind enough to host this event. It's a beautiful, awesome, I call it the Other Creation Museum. Not in a bad way, but just because the other one opened 15 years ago, and this one just opened a couple years ago. So it's the other one, right? But anyways, they're kind enough to let us use their beautiful, just absolutely drop-dead gorgeous state-of-the-art facility to as a platform to proclaim the words of the living God from heart. And we're going to do it Tuesday through Saturday, the 11th through the 15th, 10 to 3 every day, give or take, but we'll start at 10 Central Time. It'll be live streamed. People can come in person and to experience something they've never had before. And that is, right, the whole New Testament from heart.
Yeah, that's going to be, it's going to be fantastic. I'm looking forward to seeing that, hearing it. For those of you who are listening and watching right now, there will be a link to both of those, to the live stream, which I'm assuming will remain active even after it's been finished so that you can watch through as much of that. I know that Aaron House is also a part of this. He's been interviewed. We've had him on as part of as one of the guests here on the show, and I think he's presenting as well. Is that right?
Yeah, he's, you know, we need more young people like him who have a desire to memorize it and to get out there and do it. So
exactly.
But look, most of the people doing it, you know, these are not trained professionals. These are normal people, just like everyone listening, people who love the Lord and who love his word. And if these people can do it, right, who are extra, you know, super, you know, polished, gifted artists or anything, then you can do it too. You know, you can hide God's word in your heart and see the benefits that come from it. So it's, if you just go to icr.org, there'll be a link to it there, to their YouTube page. It'll stay up there forever. And like you said, thankfully, let's put some links down below, but it's going to be really amazing.
Yeah. I'm assuming everybody's going to be using the version that they memorized in. So I think you're King James. I think Aaron, if I remember right, he's like ESV or something, or so everybody will just say it in their own version.
Yeah. I'll do Revelation and New King James, but most of the other passages I have are King James. But yeah, you know, it'll all be mainstream translations, NIV, ESV, KJV, etc. And so it'll be something for everyone.
Yeah, that's awesome. Just a random question as we close it out. Do you guys have anything planned, like the, what is it, 7 or 8 of you, after you're done, to like just do like a celebratory party or something like that? There's gotta be you gotta go out to eat or something like that, right?
Yeah, it's kind of neat. The whole team, we're all staying together at the same hotel, which is like 2 minutes from the Discovery Center. And we'll all, you know, eat, and we won't drink. I'm a Baptist. But anyways, and be merry. But as soon as it ends, you know, we'll have a little thing, of course, and then we all go our separate ways. And so, you know, hopefully this happens again, but it has to happen for a first time. And I'm drop dead serious, Josh. I've looked and I cannot find anywhere throughout church history, like all these councils, et cetera, where it's actually been done. So hopefully it garnishes a lot of attention from online sources. And one thing to pray about seriously for those listening is just really pray that God keeps everyone healthy, the 7 speakers, you know, because if someone gets the plague or something, or COVID or something, and they can't come, how am I going to find someone who knows all of Luke from memory at the last minute, Josh? I mean, that's not going to happen, right? There's very few people who can do that, you know? So we really need to pray that God keeps everybody healthy, God gets everybody there on time, and all that good stuff.
I hope you enjoyed that interview with Professor Tom Meyer. If you want to learn more about the Great Recital, you can go to the link that I have in the description or just visit icr.org. I'm pretty sure that they will have all of those videos on the website, or you can go to their YouTube channel where you'll find them there. I hope that this has been an encouraging thing. I hope that you will take the time to at least watch some of those videos and just see what it's like to hear the entire or just portions of the New Testament recited from memory, because I just think it is a really neat thing to have that kind of oral interpretation of the Bible, that oral recitation of the Bible for us as the body of believers. Thank you so much for taking time to watch this video. If it has been enjoyable for you, give it a thumbs up, subscribe to this channel, and leave any questions in the comments below. God bless.